Welcome back, my fellow whiskey lovers, to Beer's Blend. My name is Ronald, and well, people, it has been a while since my latest video, hasn't it? Yes, it has. Around a month, 2 months, maybe. I don't even know. But I first of all want to thank all of you for watching my videos, leaving thumbs ups, leaving comments. It was really unexpected, actually. I hadn't thought that this channel would like be something in the first place, but it actually has passed my expectations, so really nice. I thank all of you, and well, let's get to the video. Before we go and take a look at this gem of a single malt over here, I first want to talk a little bit about the setting over here, because you may have noticed that I am not in my usual chair at my glass table next to me. That's because that's in my living room. You may already know that. If not, then now you know. The whole problem with that set was the lighting was pretty awful. It's a little bit better now, actually a lot better, because I'm sitting right in front of a big window. It's actually pretty dark outside, but I still have decent lighting, so that's a plus. And the whole thing with the living room set was, well, I am not alone in this house, so yeah, you can imagine it was quite tricky to figure out when to record, when not to record, etc. So yeah, and there was another thing, and that was, well, I'm now just in my studio slash bedroom, and I have my computer here, I have my audio interface that's right here, and yeah, before I recorded in here, I had to take my audio interface, take my laptop, take it all downstairs, set it all up, cables, a lot of work, programs. I was just busy setting up the stuff and breaking it all down for like the majority of the time. And yeah, it was not really a lot of fun to do. I could, of course, like buy an external audio interface and make my laptop a little faster, put an SSD in it or something. But I'm not really feeling that. That still left me with the living room problem and the lighting problem. So I think this is a little bit better. Let me know what you think down in the comments below. And yeah, guys, I have a lot of awesome coming. That's not proper English. I have a lot of awesome stuff coming to me in the next couple weeks. I am ordering some new whiskeys. I am also taking a look at some other drinks that I want to review on this channel. Not some liqueurs. I have some liqueurs, actually. I have liqueur 40 y 3 that I want to take a look at. I have some vodkas. I have Jägermeister that I still want to review, because I really like Jägermeister, and it's not that expensive. Some rum and just some other drinks from around the globe that I got when I was in Slovenia a couple years ago. That's actually really, really nice. But yeah, I am like primarily focusing on whiskeys, but I can't like do 2 whiskey reviews a week, because that's what I want to do with this channel. Make 2 videos a week. I think that's good enough, and yeah. It seems like a fun project to me to try and establish 2 videos per week on this channel, so I hope that works out well. But yeah, I'm planning on doing just 1 whiskey video a week though, and all the video is just about some other drink, whether it's liqueur or a non-alcoholic beverage. That's like the whole thing. So yeah, let me know what you think about it in the reactions, in the comments down below. And if you have any ideas or suggestions for some whiskeys or some other spirits or drinks, let me know. Maybe even some cocktails. I do like myself some cocktails once in a while. But yeah, let's take a look at this very interesting single malt. It's a Bowmore. Well, you may have already guessed it. Yeah, and it's a 9-year-old Bowmore. Normally, I'm not really into the, like, young whiskies. Age statement whiskies are 12 and up for me. The 10-year-old, 8-year-old, it's then I would like to get like a non-age statement one, because the thing with age statement whiskies, people are always saying, oh, I would always love an age statement on my whiskey because it's better. No, it's actually not, in my opinion. You see, if they want an age statement on their whiskey, what they need to do is they need to put whiskeys in it that aren't younger than the age statement that is set on the box. So there is not a single whiskey in this whiskey that's younger than 9 years. But if you have a non-age statement whiskey, let's say what have we here? Johnny Walker, Green Label. No, Green Label has an age statement. Gold Reserve. Yeah, let's say Gold Reserve. Gold Reserve may have some whiskies that are 3 years and a day old. Remember, a whiskey can only be called... Okay. Thank you. A whiskey can only be called a whiskey if it's older than 3 years and a day. So, yeah, but in Johnny Walker Gold Label, there may be some really, really young whiskies, but there may also be a little bit of older whiskies in there. Let's say some 12-year-old, maybe even some 15-year-old, I don't know. But they can't put 15 years on it, because if they have a whiskey that's 3 years and a day in it, they have to put 3 years on it. And, well, they aren't going to do that, because people are then just like, I'm not going to get it. And it's not really a good estimate, because an age statement doesn't say anything about the quality of the whiskey. It says a little bit about the quality of the company, because if a company like puts an age statement on every single whiskey, then yeah, it's handy. But you have companies, Bowmore also, for example, doesn't put age statements on every single whiskey. And they put an age statement on this one. This is, I think, the youngest Bowmore. I'm not sure. There may be an 8-year-old somewhere out there. But this is actually a limited edition. It's quite a lot on discount. It's not that expensive. About 35 euros dollars pounds. So, yeah, with discount, you can probably get it around 30, 40. It depends on where you live. It depends on the shop. It depends on a lot of things. But it's around that price, between 35 and 45. And well, let's take a look at it. 9 years old. The reason I got this whiskey is it got a lot of positive reviews. It was on discount when I got it. And the 9 year age statement is really uncommon on whiskeys. Most of the time you see 8, 12, sometimes 10 year old, sometimes 14, and then sometimes 15. That's a little special. And well, then yeah, 16, 18, 21. That's like the normal age statement stuff, and I thought this was really interesting, but yeah, I didn't get it for the age statement. I got it because it got a little a lot of positive reviews. A lot of people actually liked it, so I decided why not pick it up. So Bowmore was established in 1797, so end of the 18th century. Yes, talking is very difficult. Irish single malt Scotch whiskey, a perfect balance of peat smoke, sweet trickle toffee, and zesty orange. Okay then. The first Isla malt. Was Bowmore the first on the Isle of Isla? Okay, I don't know. Could be. Just some marketing. I am not really interested in all the marketing blur. I mean, it doesn't really matter if you're the first one or the last one. The only thing that matters is the quality of the whiskey. Sherry cask matured. That's nice. I like myself some sherry whiskies. Distilled and bottled in Scotland. Okay. 40% ABV. Yes. Here we have a picture of the Bowmore number one vault. There are actually some whiskies in those vaults. They call it a vault, but it's actually just a chamber where the whiskey ages or matures, whatever you want to call it. Sherry cask matured. Isla malts are famed for their peaty smokiness, and Bowmore 9 years old is no exception. As well as taking our water from the peat-laden Lagan River, we carefully smoke our malt in a peat-fried kiln, just as our ancestors did over 200 years ago. This release has been nurtured for 9 years by the Craftsman of Bowmore Distillery, home of the oldest maturation warehouse in Scotland. Okay. Here. The first Isla malt. Bowmore's celebrate single malt has been distilled on the magic Isle of Isla, off the west coast of Scotland. Oh, you can actually see where it is. This is the west coast of Scotland, and there it is. Ever since 1779, did I say 97? I mean 1779. That's the thing about the Dutch language. We say it in reverse, like the Chinese read from right to left instead of from left to right. We do that with numbers. It's stupid. This makes it the first Islas 8. This makes it the first of Islas 8 distilleries by chronological, certainly, and by taste too, many would say. That's, you aren't gonna tell me that people are actually just like tasting this and saying, yes, this is a Bowmore and it's good because it was the first. No, it's not. It's rubbish. Don't think that way. Produced the same way today as it has been ever down to the use. Blah, 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 blah. Bowmore single malt is widely acknowledged to be among the finest of the most perfectly balanced in the world. Sure thing. Okay. Bowmore 9 years old. Matured in a combination of the finest Oloroso, sherry and bourbon cask. You have two types. My God, I can't speak today. You have two types of cherries. Not cherries, but sherries. Not the cherries in the tree, but the sherry, the drink. You have Oloroso and Perro Jimenez. Perro Jimenez is a little bit sweeter, and Oloroso is a little bit deeper and darker and a little bit more intense of a sherry. So now you know. Bowmore 9 years old reflects of natural elements that surround the number one vaults and generations of tradition within. So like a sea kind of climate. On the eye, trickle amber, breathe in rich cocoa, pepper and resin, balanced with citrus tang and wisps of Isla smoke. Sip complex sherry with peach smoke followed by dark fruit and sweet cream caramel. Savor the perfect balance of sea salt and peach smoke. Sounds very interesting, if I do say so myself. Well, that's all that's on the box. Yeah, some on the top, etc. The box is also... yeah, it has some texture to it. I don't know how to say it. You can't see it on camera because it's way too small. But like some spots on the box. It's actually a really nice box. It is cardboard, but hey, the eye wants something too. So, the Bowmore bottle is, of course, really famous for the looks, etc., etc. I do think they have coloring added to it because it doesn't say on the box. And if it doesn't say on the box or the bottle, then in my opinion, it has been colored and chill filtered. But I don't know that for certain. So don't take my guesses on that one. Hey, let's find it out, shall we? Let's go on the lovely thing called the internet. And let's find out if it has been chill filtered or colored. I would say it is. It is. Because 9 years for this color, then it has to be first filled sherry casks. Otherwise, there's no way. So, let's go to my good friend whiskey.com. And let's check out if this one has been colored, yes or no. But it is a quality product. It's nice. It's good. You can't really go wrong with a Bowmore if you like a little bit of peat. This isn't a peat monster like Lagavulin or Laphroaig. Laphroaig is not really a good example because it's a whole different kind of peat smoke. Ardmore, for example, it's not in the same postcode as those whiskies. Let's find out Bowmore 9 years. I'm really curious to find out if this has been colored, yes or no. Let's see. It was introduced in 2016, by the way. So it has been around for like a year now. And well, they are saying it's special edition, but that could just be marketing. But if you see this for a decent price and you like some other PD whiskeys, maybe some other Bowmores, then I would suggest definitely you get it. Okay, let's find out. Yes, it has been colored and it has been chill filtered. So, that's a pity. Get it? Bit? No, okay. It's a little bit of a downer to me because it's those things with mass production and you could tell it because, well, 40%, most often chill filtered whiskies are at 40%, so... It's kind of an indication. And the color, don't get me wrong, there are some pretty young whiskies, sherry whiskies, that are sherry matured and have a good color. but it hasn't been all matured in sherry casks. It has also been matured in ex-bourbon casks. If it is first fill, second fill, third fill, that I don't know. Maybe we can find out together. Okay, let me get my trusty little glass up in here. Also, a really nice... this is a thing that I really miss with some certain bottles, even some more expensive bottles. That's just the design on the cork. You see, it has texture to it. It's just nice and pleasant. Nice and pleasant to look at. And I think all... distillery should do that, because if you look at the bottle, you are seeing the top of the cork, in my case at least. So, nice plop. I would say natural cork, so that's a good thing. Smoke, sherry on the cork, pleasant, not too harsh. You can definitely like get a good idea of this whiskey just smelling the cork. Just some nice, pleasant smoke. Not that harsh smoke. It's not covering up anything, and that's really important to me. It's also not that really medicinal smoke, like Laphroaig, for example. It's the bonfire type of smoke, the wood smoke. And of course, with those lovely sherry notes, really, really like it. Not too much. I still have a couple of whiskeys to go today. So, okay, that's that. Well, color, in my opinion, it's nice. It is colored with E150 caramel coloring, of course. But do I really care about it? Honestly, I do not. I am caring a bit more about the chill filtration, because chill filtration kills in certain situations some of the expressions that a whiskey can bring to someone, and especially with peated whiskies. And I would say some lowland speyside whiskies, you aren't really going to notice it the way you notice chill filtration in a highland, in just some smoky whiskies, because for some reason the effects of chill filtration, like the smoke enhances that. And if you have a chill filtered Islay whiskey with smoke, you can. It most of the time it lacks something. If you, okay, let's just compare this one to my 16-year-old Lagavulin. It's not around the same price. It's a little bit more expensive. It's 16-year-old, almost twice the age of this one. But the smoke, etc. The Lagavulin has a lot. A lot more character to it, and that's not just because it's older. It's just because it's not chill filtered. Is it chill filtered? Is my Lagavulin chill filtered? I could have sworn Lagavulin wasn't chill filtered, because it's Lagavulin. Now I'm gonna find out, because I'm saying stuff here that's not supposed to be said if it's not true. Okay. Okay. Lagavulin, 16 years old. If it has been chill filtered, then all my things go right out the window. I could have sworn it wasn't chill filtered, by the way. I could have sworn it wasn't chill filtered. Hurry up, internet, you're taking way too much out of my time. It has been colored and it has been chill filtered. Oh damn. Okay, excusez-moi, never mind. But a lot of people are saying that with chill filtered whiskies, a little bit of the character goes away. But, are you going to notice it? That's the case. If it's good, it's good. With or without chill filtration, yeah, you can ask yourself what you think about that one. I honestly don't really care, as long as it's a good whiskey. So yeah, that's that. On the nose. Straight off the bat, smoke, peat smoke. Sherry, of course, a lot of sherry, dark sherries. I am actually getting some resin, some sultanas, some actual cherries. But there's definitely no Peregrina sherry in this one. It's the deeper, the darker Oloroso sherry that's prominent in this one. I It's hard, but I can sense a little bit of the ex-bourbon cask characteristics. For example, the vanilla, a little bit sweet, just some wood sugars. Yeah, that's definitely in this whiskey. Also, maybe some figs, some plums. Definitely some plums. It's just the dark sherry, and I am even thinking that the sherry gets intensified by the peat smoke. This isn't a really peated whiskey. I would say the sherry and the peat smoke are in perfect balance. They balance each other perfectly. They enhance each other, but they're not overpowering to one another. You know what I mean? And that's the thing with some other whiskeys. Smoke can be a little bit overpowering at sometimes. If you get it with, it's hard. But if you get a little further away from the glass, you are starting to notice those bourbon characteristics. Yes. There are some people that add water to their whiskies, let it sit for a moment. In my opinion, you could do it. Because there are a couple fist rules with whiskies. You should have it as long in your mouth as that it's old. You don't need to have it 9 years in your mouth, but for 9 seconds in this case. But if you have a 16-year-old whiskey, 16 seconds. You know what I mean? And that same thing goes for the whiskey in the glass, but then it's a minute. So if I want to really like get into it and stuff, I have to let it sit for 9 minutes. But I don't know if I'm feeling that. It's definitely the case with some older ones, because old whiskeys need to open up. That's definitely the case. I am also confident and convinced that you have to like keep it in your mouth in seconds for how old it is. But in younger whiskeys, with younger whiskeys, you don't have to like let it sit for 9 minutes or 8 minutes or 3 minutes if you have a really, 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 really young one. But yeah, I'm also searching for a little bit of that metallic note that you find with some younger whiskies, because that's always my fear, like the alcohol, the youngness, the youthness, that kind of stuff. And I can't really sense it in the nose. And that's also the thing with island whiskies. The peat smoke covers up that youthness. So that's why I think Bowmore got this out. Because really young whiskies from like Speyside, even some Highland whiskies, you can always sense a little bit of the youthness. This you cannot, at least not in the nose. And in my opinion, the taste, It's an intense whiskey in the taste, because it's young, but I can't really sense alcohol or that metallic youthness in the taste and in the nose. What else am I getting? Just that cherry characteristic. You can fill it in for yourself, but it's... If they put a 12-year-old age on this whiskey, I would have believed it. Definitely. Because it's really nicely balanced by everything that's going on. It isn't really that complex, but it's a young whiskey. You can't expect to have everything, of course. Just a small sip. Yeah, it's intense. It has a little bit of that smokiness in the back. Steady arrival, but it quickly turns a little bit peppery. And what's the word I'm looking for? A little bit chili type, hot. What's the word? I'm okay. Brain, major brain fart going on. Spicy. That's the word. That's the word I was looking for. It's spicy. A long aftertaste. That's a nice thing. Nice mouthfeel. If they went higher with the ABV, like 43%, the whiskey would get too intense. It would get too intense. And now you can just enjoy the smokiness in the back, the sherry feeling on your tongue. It's a little bit spicy, prickly, peppery. It's nicely balanced. It's smooth. It's not that complex. You know what's going on. But the thing that I have with young whiskies, sometimes they're a little bit overpowering. They're like, bam, and here I am, you know? This is mellow, smooth, easy to drink. But it's definitely spicy and it's quite intense. Definitely, it's not boring. I think Bowmore did the right thing with the chill filtration in this case, at least lowering the ABV. I am not a master blender or a malt master or whatever you want to call it, so I don't know how the whole chill filtration and ABV go together. And yeah, I don't know, but I do know that with chill filtration, most of the time the ABV gets lower. That's what I know, at least in whiskey terms. Chill filtered whiskeys are often a lower ABV. That's what I'm trying to say. And if they would have gone with a higher ABV, it would have overpowered the smokiness, the low smokiness. I would say it's around 20-25 ppm in here. Not a lot, but it's present, it's there, and it's enjoyable. It's not a peat monster, it's not a sherry monster, it's nicely balanced. And I think that's why Bowmore just put a 9-year-old age statement on the whiskey, because it's just a good whiskey. It's not an amazing one, it's not perfect, it's just pleasant. Let me go back to that. It's perfect in its own right. For a 9-year-old whiskey, you can't get a lot better, at least not in the price range. You have to really search for it. And the aftertaste and the finish is quite long. And the mouthfeel is not watery. It's not a watery whiskey. It's nice. It's solid. It has character to it. In the finish, it's when you swallow it, it gets a little bit intense, spicy. It builds up, but it also mellows down quite fast. And that's what I really like about this whiskey. It has some things that you wouldn't expect, that you would expect for like 16-year-old whiskeys or 18-year-olds. But this one has it as well, for a really affordable price. So if you like Bowmores in general, and some smoky whiskies and sherry whiskies, get this one. Don't search anywhere else, just get this one. And if you like this one, then go searching a little bit further. This is a perfect whiskey in its own right. Am I going to give it a 10? No. Why? I would like to have just natural color in my whiskey. I don't need it to be colored. I mean, sherry whiskey. Really? I don't think you need coloring for it. It's 9 years. It looks like 16 years. Yeah. No. Just normal color. Please, Bowmore. Please. You're putting an age statement on it, but you're fooling us with the color. No. Not nice. Not nice. But what am I going to give it? I think I'm going to give it a solid 8.5. Just a solid 8.5. It's a solid whiskey for a solid price. I'm just a little bit worried about the price, because I have seen it above 40, and I think it's just too much for it. I think 30, 35, it's perfect. I mean, Bowmore is a quality brand. You get quality no matter what you buy from Bowmore. That's just the thing. With certain companies, you are just going to get a good quality whiskey. Whether you like it or not, that's on you. But the whiskey is just good quality. That's just the thing. And Bowmore is really big, big brand. They know what they're doing. And yeah, of course, not everybody has to like their whiskeys. No, of course not. Some people can say, oh, I don't like this. Oh, I don't like that. But in general, with such brands, you can take a gamble. That's what I'm saying. If you don't really know, am I going to like it? The taste notes seem nice on the box, but I'm not really sure. Yeah, just try it. At least if the price is right, of course. You shouldn't do that with really expensive whiskeys. But with some whiskeys around this price category, you cannot go wrong, really. It also depends, of course, what you're used to. I'm used to mid to kind of low high range whiskeys, not the really expensive stuff, but around the 70-80 euro whiskeys, and somewhere between 30-40. I really like it. I like it, but it's a whiskey that needs a certain moment. That's the thing, because I haven't really spent a lot of time with it, as you can see. But I do like it a lot. I do like it a lot. But this is a whiskey. If the moment is right, the whiskey is right. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, probably. Or probably not. Who knows? But 8.5 from me. What are we going to review next? I don't know. I don't know. Let's find out. My fellow malt lovers, I thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. And if you live in Holland, I think it's on discount at drankdozijn.nl at the moment. So check it out, maybe buy it. Just keep your eye out for this this bottle. It's often on discount. And if it's on discount, then it's a bargain. Absolutely a bargain. It's not perfect, but it's just a good, decent whiskey. Yeah. That's all for now. Hope you liked it. Leave a thumbs up. Share this video with your friends. Why not? And, well, I will see you next time. Goodbye.